and praise the Lord with all of our hearts this morning at Bell Road Baptist Church.
Anytime our heart turns from darkness to light, anytime temptation comes and someone stands to fight, anytime somebody lives to serve and not be served,
gospel isn't always at the center. And he said, and sometimes it's in really deceptive ways. He said, not that they're intending to. He said, it's just so easy for what we want to hear, what the pastor thinks the church members want to hear in larger churches, to just, you know, take a segue. We're just, this week, we're going to talk about something a little else. He said, but that's really missing the point, isn't it? He said, if the gospel isn't at the center of every single thing that you do in your church, in your own spiritual lives, in your prayer, he said, how many times is I can find myself praying for something that I know either I need or a church member needs? He said, those are great prayers. He said, but I look back and I'm like, man, there wasn't any gospel in there at all. It was just something that I wanted. It wasn't any gospel at all. He said, the way that we speak to others, and the way that we do things, and the way that even in our own lives think and do for ourselves, the gospel must be at the center. It's because you find that it changes the way in which we see everything else. Everything else. And it's so tempting to just, we'll talk about the gospel with so-and-so for the next time. I'm sure I'll see him next week. This time we'll just talk about the draft. This time, we'll just talk about what I had for lunch. It was delicious. Next time, we'll talk about the gospel. Next time, we'll get there. And sometimes, next time never comes. Maybe the only opportunity you've got, maybe the only opportunity you'll ever get, maybe the only opportunity that they'll see in a long time. The gospel must be at the center of everything that we do. Let's pray this prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together this morning. We thank you for May of 2021. And Lord, we pray right now that May just be the year that the gospel explodes. The gospel explodes in our hearts. The gospel explodes in our lives and in our minds and in our churches and in our children and in Nashville and in Antioch and in the state of Tennessee and all over. God, we pray that the history of earth looks back on May 2021 and says, something amazing happened then. Father, we just pray that you just allow us to keep your gospel at the front of our mind. Lord, this gift that you've given to us, may it change our lives for these days going forward. In Jesus' name we pray.
Sing with me now. Oh, and let
Lord. Amen. And we get the opportunity to do that now.
Count a million times people asking me how I can praise you with all that I've gone through. The question just amazes me. Can circumstances possibly change who I forever am in you?
We change.
Change long before these rainy days. It's never really ever crossed my mind to turn my back on you, oh Lord, my only shelter from the storm. But instead, I draw closer through these times. So holy, 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 hol
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. Amen?
Amen.
That's who we've come to worship today. There's no other reason to be here but to worship the Lord. And I just want to say thank you for that beautiful music. And I'm glad you're here today and wanting to study the Word of God today. That's glad you're here. I'm going to preach a sermon to those that aren't here, so I need your help to share this message. But I wanted to share a message. I've read so much about people not coming back to church. Churches are reopening and people aren't coming back. And I've heard as high as 30% of those who used to come to church before COVID actually said they would not be coming back. And so I wanted to look at this issue of coming back to church and worshiping again together. And I want to share with you as a word of encouragement. But I want to share with you as a message to get out there and call not only our church family, who you've not seen here lately. There's a directory in the back, purple directory. You can get one of those and look through there. But maybe you have family and friends who are not going back to their church or their church isn't open yet. Invite them to come and worship with us. We would love to have them come. But there's a new phrase, a new word has come out of the COVID crisis the past year. And I got this, the local news, WTBF, had an article by Olivia Michael. And she said that she interviewed the Vanderbilt behavioral health leader, Dr. Saxena. And she said, they call this new phobia, it's called re-entry anxiety. Re-entry anxiety. And she said that you may not sleep well, you may feel anxious, you may feel worried, you may have wanted to cancel things, you avoid the situation. And so we're seeing sports events open back up. Movie houses are opening back up, concerts are coming back this summer. But a lot of people have this re-entry anxiety, and I wondered if our church members have that. Do some of our church members have re-entry anxiety?
No.
All right, that's the end of my sermon. Jeannie has ended the sermon, and that's it. Well, I don't see everybody here, Jeannie, so one of us is wrong. Either you're wrong or I'm wrong. I don't see that we had 45 people the Sunday that we felt that we needed to close the doors. And so something's happened. And so I want to share this from God's Word. And I want to encourage you to call someone this week that you know has not come back or someone that's afraid. And just share these verses with them that I'm going to give you today. But re-entry anxiety has no place here for the Lord's people.
That's right.
Why people might not come back. There's a great article by Carl Waters that we had this week in our press areas. And he said, here's some of the reasons. And his number one was, they got out of the habit. And I thought, ooh, man, I hope going to church isn't a habit.
Right.
But he said, for a lot of people, it's just a habit. They were children, they came to church. And they've always gone to church, and we had the shutdown, and they just got out of the habit. They found other things to do on Sundays. And so we need to talk to those folks about their habits. Another one that really hurt was they haven't missed it. Ouch. They quit coming, we closed the doors, and they found out over the months that they haven't missed coming to church. That's our fault. If people aren't coming because they never missed it. They've found outdoor activities, they watch church online, they haven't missed it. Another reason he said was this was the break, COVID was the break they've been waiting for. a reason not to come to church. And some people have been that way. They've reported that. They were just barely coming in the first place and not sure why they were there. And so COVID gave them an excuse to stay home. And so we want to share with them a good reason to come back. Some have health risks, and I agree with that. Some have lung diseases and heart diseases and cancer. And maybe they were coming, it was hard for them, but with COVID, they just stayed home. We want to meet them, encourage them, and talk to them. Another reason that he gave for why people aren't coming back is fear. People are afraid. People are afraid to go out. And so we want to talk to them about fear. And then he said the church hasn't reached out to them. Their names aren't in our book if we haven't reached out to them, because we've tried to keep in touch with everybody. But maybe we've missed some people, and we need to apologize to them and share with them again. But I think that the reason that hurt the most was we haven't given them a compelling reason to come back. And that's what I want to do today, is share with you from Scripture why we need to be here on the first day of the week, worshiping the Lord together. We do live streaming. Our church service is available, I think, on Facebook and YouTube, and it's on this tube, and I think it's on that tube. So I've heard of people say my parents watch our service, and other people have watched our service. So why can't, we did this for a while. Sandy came, and Tracy, and I came, and Judy, and we did the service right here, just us. So if you get our service online anytime, why don't you stay home and watch the service? And there are a lot of benefits to online. This is from Diecast, who provides live video streaming. So they're in this for doing it. But you can reach parishioners from far. This is broadcast around the world on internet. You serve the homebound, and we want to do that. You expand your reach. Bypass space limitations. We don't want to pack out the church. Connect with youth, host community events. Capture the service for our archive so that years from now people can look up the service and it'll be online. And then they go on, and then at the end of that, how you can have online service through a Diecast. So there are great reasons to do this, and we want to keep having an online presence for all of those reasons. So with that in mind, why gather together as believers on Sunday morning? Why not just stay home with that? And so the first reason I want to share, I want us to go to Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3, beginning in verse 7. And I want to look at what the church is for. If we don't have to come back, then we don't need a church. We don't need the church. So what does the New Testament say is the purpose of the church? That's us. You and me, we're the church. So let's look at Ephesians 3. I'm going to begin in 7. Let's stand together for the reading of God's Word. Paul writes to Ephesus, "I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of His power. Although I am less than the least of all God's people, this grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God, who created all things. God's intent," verse 10, Ephesians 3, 10, "God's intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realm, according to God's eternal purpose, which He accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. In Jesus Christ, and through faith in Jesus, we have approached to God with freedom and confidence. I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my suffering for you, which are for your glory." Father, we thank you for this passage of Scripture. that you created the church. You chose the church to share this gospel of Jesus Christ with the world. We pray that you would find us ready and willing and active in sharing that good news of the gospel. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So that first reason, why come back? Why be here? Why invite your friends to come? Thelma, thank you for inviting your friend. When we all start inviting our friends, we'll fill this place up. We're so glad you're here today.
Thank you.
Lisa.
I'm all the way from Cincinnati.
Cincinnati. It's not that far.
Not at all.
Number one, corporate worship. Corporate worship. That's something you can't do at home. On the internet. With your cell phone. You can watch the show, but the Bible talks about the church. And it's and the purpose of the church, we say this, Sandy says this, Tracy says this, is to worship the Lord together.
Amen.
So that God can hear our voices worshiping Him. John chapter 4 is the account of Jesus and the Samaritan woman. John chapter 4, verse 23. He offers water to, or he asks for water from this Samaritan woman who comes to the well. And she says, you shouldn't be asking me this. You're a Jew. You're a rabbi. And then she starts in on this worship thing. We've got our worship place here in Samaria. You've got your worship place in Judea and Jerusalem. And Jesus cuts through all of that. And in verse 23, John chapter 4, Jesus tells her, a time is coming, and now has come, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and truth. That's plural. That's plural. Jesus said, you don't need to go anywhere. You don't need to go to Samaria. You don't need to come to Jerusalem. Just do your own thing. Jesus said, we worship the Lord, we come together, and we worship in spirit and in truth. It's not about a place, it's not about a format. It's about gathering together and worshiping in spirit and in truth. Yes, we have these ways to worship, and we thank the Lord for technology and all of that, but you in your home alone, you can't have that corporate time where we're together and worshiping together. A second reason that I wanted to give you is from 1 Corinthians 12. You can read 1 Corinthians 12. Someone says, I don't need to go to church. I worship at home. And you have these great preachers on TV, and they have great sermons. You can watch those. I found out through COVID that I don't have to go. Just read them, 1 Corinthians 12. The church is the body of Christ. And we are members. Each person's a member of that body of Christ. And we have gifts. And we have a purpose. And we have a reason is to be here. Every one of you. Let me share from 1 Corinthians 12. I'll start in verse 7. Each one, that's you. Each one, that's me. Each one has a manifestation, a gift from the Holy Spirit for the common good. The spiritual gifts aren't for you. Prophecy, faith, and giving, and all of those gifts, they're not for you. They're for the church to be shared in the ministry of the church. Verse 8, to one there's given wisdom, to another knowledge, faith, healing, miraculous powers, prophecy, distinguishing spirits, tongues, interpretation of tongues. Verse 11, 1 Corinthians 12, 11, all these are the work of one and the same Spirit as He distributes them to each one, just as the Holy Spirit determines. Verse 12, listen, 1 Corinthians 12, 12, just as your body is one body but has many parts, but all of the parts form one body, so it is with Christ, Jesus Christ. For we are all baptized by one Spirit, to form one body. So the body is not made up of many parts, but one part, but of many. And you can read that whole chapter. You have been received Christ as Savior and Lord. You have followed Him in believer's baptism. You have a spiritual gift. You have a gift. You have a purpose. And that gift is to serve the body of Christ. Jesus died on the cross for our sins. He was buried. He rose again the third day. He ascended into heaven on the 40th day. And now the church is His body.
Praise the Lord.
The church is His body. And we're all members of that body. Some are eyes, and some are noses, and some are mouth, and some are hands and feet and heart. And we all have a part. And so when you're not here, the body of Christ suffers. The body of Christ suffers. Because you're not here with your gift, your spiritual gift of encouragement and prayer and ministry to the church. We are one body. I like Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. We love those two verses. And we quote them all the time. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For by grace you've been saved through faith. That's not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Period. That's where we stop. It's about me. I've been saved by my faith, by grace. God saved me. And we forget verse 10. You got to keep reading. You got to take verses in their context. You need to read the whole chapter, not just pick out a verse. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For by grace you've been saved through faith. That's not of yourselves. It's a gift of God. Not of works. Not of works. And then he goes on and says, verse 10. Because. For. See? Why was I saved by grace? Why was I saved through faith? Why is it not of works? Why should I not boast? Because we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. That salvation by grace is not about me. It's about the church. The church growth, serving the Lord, working for Him. And these works have been prepared by God to do. Do you want to be a part of God? Do you want to be a part of God's will? You've got to be here on Sunday morning to be a part of that work, that creation, serving the church and doing what the Lord has. And all of us are praying Luke 10. All of us are praying Luke 10, 1 and 2. The Lord looked at the South Nashville. Jesus looked on South Nashville and saw all the languages that are here and the people that have moved in here. And Jesus said, ask, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send workers out to His harvest field. You can't do that at home. You can't do that at home with a cell phone and church or a TV and a church service. It's this church. We're going to come together. We're going to find a way to reach South Nashville for Christ together. And so we do that. The church is one body. That's why they need to come back. Why in the world do I need to come back to church? Read 1 Corinthians 12. You got a minute? Let me read something to you. Try it. They'll never ask you that again. We're a body. We're a family, a church family. A third reason is a commandment. A third reason is a command. We don't choose this reason. Bear one another's burdens. Aren't you thankful for Bell Road Baptist Church? When you were down, when you had a hard time, when you were in the hospital, weren't you thankful for Bell Road Baptist Church? And we do have the internet, we do have the texts. That's good. I like to get those texts and share those and everybody writes back. But man, to come here and know you're praying for me and asking about me and the family, we bear one another's burdens. To know when you have a problem that you share, isn't it nice to know the church is there with you, praying for you,
yes,
thinking about you, ready to do anything? Is there anything I can do for you? Just call me. Isn't that great?
Yes.
Amen.
We have a guy that lives behind us. I feel so sorry for him. He lives alone. He lives in the unit behind us. Lives all alone. Goes on walks. Keeps his head down. Doesn't always wave. He's alone. But he doesn't seem to want any friends. You know, he's just alone. And I try to say hello. And Judy, he won't even say hello to Judy, okay? All right? I should rest my case.
Right.
Everybody loves Judy. But for some reason, he's chosen just to live alone. Well, yesterday, the fire truck pulled up, the 911 truck pulled up, the police pulled up to our house, right? You know, can't miss that. And we went out there and see if there's anything we could do. And they hauled him out on a stretcher. You know, I thought, who is he going to call? Who's going to help him? Who's going to go see him, take care of him? Like, you know, it breaks your heart at how many people are all alone, living in their houses alone, afraid to get out. And here's the most loving church family.
Amen.
Right here. So share with those that aren't coming. Listen, I wouldn't miss it. I wouldn't miss the music. I wouldn't miss the fellowship. In 3 weeks, I wouldn't miss the buffet. There's reasons to come. Save, serve. Exercise your gift. Bear one another's burdens. Galatians 6 is a commandment. Galatians 6, verse 1. Brothers and sisters, if someone's caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person, but watch yourselves that you're not tempted. Verse 2. Galatians 6, 2. Carry each other's burdens. And listen. And in this way you fulfill the law of Christ. Mm-hmm. Don't you want to do that? Don't you want to fulfill the law of Christ? Don't you want to do God's will and be a part of His will? Bear one another's burdens. Therefore, verse 10, this is Galatians 6, 10. As we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. I'm so thankful for Bell Road family. I really am. I'm just so thankful. I've had that myself. There's a month, I don't remember, it was November, this past November. But Judy said, you guys were all there. I was in the hospital. I'm trying to forget all that right now. But I have these four holes right here in this. But thank you. Thank you, church. The body of Christ. Bear one another's burdens. Thank you so much. A fourth reason to come back to church is to have fellowship with Christ. Wait. That's wrong. I have Jesus as my Savior. Yes, He lives in me. Yes, I've got fellowship with Christ. True. Why did Jesus say in fellowship with Christ, Matthew 18, wherever two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. Why did Jesus teach his disciples about the church? Tell it to the church. Again, if any two of you agree on anything they ask for, it'll be done. Because wherever two or three gather in my name, I'm there with them. There's a special relationship with Jesus through the church. You see, by yourself, yes, Jesus is there. But there's a ministry, effective agreement with Jesus when we're gathered together and we agree on these things. And we love one another, share with one another. The church, Jesus is here with us in this place. I want to be here. I want some of that. I want to be here and experience the presence of the Lord in this way, through His body, through His family. And that's why we come to this place, to have fellowship with the Lord. The Great Commission, Matthew 28, 19 and 20. Jesus is sharing with His disciples to go. And He's talking to them. Verse 19, make disciples, baptize everyone, teach everyone, and I will be with you to the end of the age. And that's what we want to do at Bell Road. We want to go anywhere and everywhere. We want to share the gospel. We want people to receive Christ, and we want to baptize them. And we want to teach them how to live the Christian life. And we do that because we know that Jesus is going to be with us. So how do we reach the ones that aren't here? We're missing about 20 people, and I know that every one of you knows someone else that could be. There were 20 people that never came back after I came. That hurt my feelings. Bad. But then I heard about this person used to come, and this person used to come. We had names and addresses. And Brother Richard, good old Brother Richard, he's back there in the corner. We visited every one of them, and they never came back. So I know there are a lot of people who don't come to church. What can we do? First, the first thing we need to do is to encourage them to come back. Let's just make a phone call. Get the directory out there before you go and write down the names of people you don't see here and just give them a call. And say, we missed you. We're back together again. God's working. We've got answered prayers. We need you back here. Another suggestion was, offer them an experience they cannot get online. I accept responsibility for that. Sandy accepts responsibility for that. Tracy accepts responsibility for that. But you all have to give them an experience, and that's that fellowship, that welcome, that how are you? I've been praying for you. That family, that body life is going to give them a reason to come back here. Reach out to them. Number four was apologize if we need to. I'll do that. I'll do the apologizing. If you call someone up and they say, nobody's called me, nobody's reached out to me, Phil, just tell me. Tell me who it is. Judy and I will go make a porch visit. I will apologize for them. I missed them somehow. But we may need to apologize to some people because they weren't contacted. And then I like the fifth one that I found. Give them an opportunity to serve. We need to do that. We need to give every member an opportunity to serve the Lord. We had someone came early this morning and used a weed eater. And we had someone who was going to come Saturday and do something. And we got someone took care of the roof. And someone called someone else. And we minister to the family, you see. So give the people that aren't coming, give them a reason to come back. We need you back here. We need your ministry, not just to come and sit, but to have a reason to come back. I want to close with a story I read this week by Mac McPhail, and he said, will they come back? Will they come back? And he told the story about his minister went to Africa on a mission trip, and they went way out in the bush, an isolated area, and he noticed that the church was vibrant and alive, and they sang, and they preached. And they sang and they preached. And they sang and they preached for 5 hours. 5 hours. And the pastor was amazed. He said, if I go past 12 o'clock, I'm dead. And so he asked the African pastor, he said to the African pastor, how do you get people to stay in church for 5 hours? And the pastor said, look around. What else is there to do? What else is there to do? And the pastor was remembering, you know, in our days, 10 years ago, we had black and white TV with 3 channels. And we had to turn the antenna to get the channel. And we didn't have email, we didn't have internet, we didn't have computers, we didn't have cell phones. And we came to church. I remember on Sundays, we'd been all day. Monday night was Monday night visitation. Wednesday night was a long evening. We had a sandwich supper, and then weekly workers meeting, youth choir, big choir, prayer meeting. And then Friday night was youth night. We were all here for that. Saturday was visitation. Sunday, good grief. Well, there wasn't anything else to do.
Well, I can't now.
Well, now we found something to do all the time. I don't have it, it's right here with me. Cell phone, computer, internet, camping, whatever you want to do. We have found things to do. And so today, more than ever, we need to bring God's people back to fellowship with the church. And we need to read 1 Corinthians 12 and let them know that they're missed. They're a part of the body of Christ. So like I said, I'm not preaching to you all. You have your reason for being here. I hope it's not habit. I hope it's not habit. I hope you're here to worship the Lord. But we've got a big job to do. We had a big job before COVID. It's just made more challenging now with COVID. We've got to encourage people to come back. And we'll do whatever it takes to get people to come back. We'll get them an isolated seat. We'll put plastic up. You know, whatever it takes. We need the body of Christ here. And so you know those people. You know your friends. You know your neighbors that are missing out. And when they say, I found out, it's been nice, on Sunday mornings I found out I can do church at home. Be kind. Don't use guilt. Just say, no, you can't. We're the body of Christ. We want you to come and experience Belleville.
It's a love.